Hey everybody, it's Annie. Welcome back to my channel. I am so excited because I have homeschool videos for you guys again. There's always a lull kind of mid-school year, which for us is like December, January, February. There's not a whole lot of YouTube homeschool content that I have or want to put out for you guys. But since we are wrapping up the 2020 to 2021 school year, I want to take some time and talk about the curriculum and a few other things related to that that I used this year, what I liked, what I didn't like. I was preparing for this video and realized I'm going to break this into two parts. This first part, I'm going to talk about the things that worked, the things that hands down made this one of the best homeschool years that we have ever had. It was so amazing. Even though we have about 6 weeks officially left in our school year, I'm still kind of excited. I'm excited to finish well. And a huge part of that is because of the different books and curriculums and things that we used. Next time, I will do the part where I talk about the things that I really didn't like and I probably won't try again. And I like to be very specific and talk about why I don't think they worked for our family, because I don't really think there's a bad curriculum on the market, but I do think you have to take a lot of things into consideration, such as me as the teacher and my teaching style or my interaction style with my kids, and also especially how my kids learn. So I'll do that in a separate video. This one is just the things that I want to rave about and the things that I enjoyed and that worked so well. So let me kind of push this pile off to the side. I'm going to zoom in a little bit and try to stay in frame the entire time. One of the things I want to show you is my teacher planner. This was my first year using an Anavance PaperCo planner, and I really figured out that, one, not only do I love the planner in general, but with me and my personality and my planning style, the day-to-day lesson planning evolves over the course of the year. And I was able to just make a few easy for me tweaks to continue using this planner for the whole school year, which is this is like only the second year that I think that I've actually used a teacher planner consistently through the whole year, which is really weird. If you know me from my channel, the bulk of my videos on this channel are actually planner related. So I'm a planner girl. So hands down, this is my favorite planner. I really loved how it organized my attendance. So I was able to do attendance in the beginning pages. You can see we're still going strong and we have the rest of the year. I was able to use the lesson planning pages, and then there are plenty of reference pages. I've walked you guys through this as I've updated and used it throughout the school year. I'm pretty sure I have at least 3, if not 4 videos specifically on this homeschool planner and how I'm using it. So please check those out. But continuing to use these as my checklists and the different things and ways that I use my planner, it's just been amazing. Okay, the other reason I have this out is because I actually had forgotten some of the things that we used at the beginning of the school year. Now, the things that we dropped, like I said, are going to be in the next video, but let me pull this off to the side. I'm going to use it for reference, and I want to talk about the things that absolutely, hands down, worked and were amazing in our school year. So, this current school year, my kids' ages always change. They all have school year birthdays. So at the beginning of the school year, they're one age, and right now they have all just had a birthday. So currently my kids are 11, 9, and 6, and those are my school age kids, and those are the ones you're gonna see the bulk of the curriculum for. I do also have, he just turned 5 a few days ago, so he was kind of a preschooler this year, and I have she's now 3, but when we started the school year, she was 2, so just like a toddler. And I will either be talking about a few books that I've used for them in the next video, or I'll do a separate one, because they both kind of surprised me this year, and I did do some stuff with them. But this was all my planned curriculum. So okay, this will be a little choppy because I had to just cut myself off there and go check on my kids. This is my 6-year-old's math. Now, she is my one student who is not advancing to the next grade on an academic calendar. She's actually more of a regular January through December calendar. So when we started the school year, she was doing the second book of level K math. So she basically started the school year finishing up kindergarten and has made her way halfway through first grade by the time we finish this year. So it is a little bit confusing, but it's also one of those benefits of homeschooling. She just wasn't ready on kind of the academic year to really begin kindergarten and preschool. And when she was ready, we have been moving at a very normal pace and she is doing fantastic. So always do what you feel is right for your individual kids. But I cannot say enough about Horizons Math. You'll see in my What Didn't Work video, another math curriculum we've tried, and it's not as good. I love Horizons Math. It is just so straightforward. It's colorful. It is spiral learning method. So they are always being introduced to new topics, but always also reviewing things that they have learned before. So they don't forget things and they are constantly reviewing them. It helps my kids so they are not frustrated with forgetting things or having to dig into something for so long it becomes tedious. It's always a little different. It's always a little challenging. And one thing that I have learned is always be the master of your curriculum and don't let your curriculum be your master. So because a lot of curriculum will often begin kind of review at the beginning of a new school year, like I just said, my daughter just finished kindergarten and started first grade days apart. So a lot of the beginning of this book is way basic for her and things that she learned very early on in the kindergarten books. But usually you would maybe do this with an entire summer break and you need that refresh. So the way that we handle that is we just skip things. If I know my daughter can do this perfectly with no issues, it's one of her strengths, it's something that she gets, we just skip it. You'll see I have things crossed out sometimes, and it just helps us not to get bogged down and kill the spirit of learning, because who wants to continue to repeat things that you truly have mastered? So we absolutely love Horizons, and my kids usually work through the kindergarten, first and second books, like second grade books, before they're finally old enough to do teaching textbooks. So my two older kids, I hope you can see this. I don't know if you can see me reflected or my camera. We'll do the best we can here. But this is teaching textbooks. We have two Kindle Fires, one for my son, one for my daughter, for school. They're family tablets in general if we're going to use them for games or anything like that. But when it comes to school, this one is for my daughter. We do teaching textbooks, math. By the way, a little caveat, I cannot wait. I'm going to do an entire video dedicated to why I love teaching textbooks, why I am going to use it for all of my kids, probably all through their entire education, and especially just rave about all the improvements and updates, one of which is that you can have it on a device like this instead of on a computer. It's so user-friendly. My kids love it. They enjoy it. They're thriving. And I find that Horizons is the perfect foundation, like I said, through about level two, which they equate with about a second grade. And then the first level available with teaching textbooks is level three. And I feel like the transition is perfect. And also the style between the two is very similar. And it really just makes it so easy for me to teach my young ones and give a great foundation and then kind of pass them off and delegate a math subject while feeling 100% confident that they are learning, they are being challenged, and they are quickly moving at what I consider a very rigorous and academic approach to math while still keeping it as fun as possible. So for my three official school age kids, two did teaching textbooks, different levels. One did Horizons, and absolutely love them. I highly recommend both math programs. Of course, I don't know what it's like after second grade math with Horizons because we switched to teaching textbooks. So at least for the early beginning kindergarten, first, second, and even preschool, I love Horizons, and then I love teaching textbooks. So math was a winner ringer this year. It was actually a no-brainer and I didn't regret it. And it was pretty easy to pick coming into the school year because I had used them both before in previous years. So that was amazing. Another subject that we absolutely love, a curriculum we absolutely love, and I haven't had to change partway through the year or seriously tweak, is Story of the World. So this is our first year where we did it consistently. I got this book with like a month left of the last school year, and we went through a couple of the lessons just to see if it's something that I wanted to do. I absolutely loved it. When we started this current school year, we started over. So that way, you know, because we had the whole summer as a break, and review never hurt anybody. I absolutely love the textbook. The only thing that I noticed is in one of the chapters we did not that long ago, they did a retelling of a story of, I'm pretty sure it was Odysseus. Yeah, it was this one, Odysseus and the Cyclops. And even my 11-year-old, he was a little bit shocked because the ogre ends up eating a couple of the good guys. It's not graphic, but I was like, and I just felt like for children, if I had proofed it beforehand, which I don't, I would have totally just skipped that story. So moral of the story is I'm going to be a little more cautious and read ahead a little bit or flip ahead for the next few years because I know my kids, and I'm also going to be bringing up a couple of younger kids next year that are even younger than like my current age kids. So that's the only kind of complaint or critique that I would have, is that like one of the stories that I've come across so far, I felt like I wouldn't have picked. But you know what? There's never a perfect curriculum, ever. There's going to be teeny tweaks. So we loved it. We loved reading this. We focused in the activity book portion. I almost always use the review questions and then I ask for a narration, because we did not start our homeschool journey when, you know, my oldest was in preschool. We did not start. I didn't know anything about narration. I didn't know about the Charlotte Mason style of education. And I really love what narration can do and what dictation can do. And so this was new to us this year, really, was the narration emphasis. So I use both the review questions and the narration for my older two. And I have just started in the last couple of weeks to include my six-year-old in the review questions. But that is only if she stays to listen. This year, she gets a pass. If she is off playing, I do not call her to do history with us. I only do it with my older two kids. Next year, she will be officially in first grade and beginning her second grade year as well, probably halfway through. And I will require her to sit and listen and do, she will probably want to do the maps. So that was the other thing we did. In the back, it came with all of the maps. You can just tear out the pages that you want. There's also some activity pages and coloring pages. I did not do a bunch of those, but I probably will next year to help my first grader want to be a part of listening and participating. But we focus on the maps. I have all the maps, one for each of my oldest two for this current year, and we go over the map work. So for us, what really worked was also the schedule that we did this. We read the chapter usually in one day, unless it was a very long one. So I know I have an example. So this one was in two parts. Greece's war with Persia was just a couple pages, and I read that on Monday. I think we read that on Tuesday. Today is a Wednesday, and we read the Greeks fight each other, which was a couple more pages, and then we did the map today. So that is how we've been doing it. We're doing it at our own pace and not exactly as is recommended. The other thing that I absolutely love are the additional history reading and corresponding literature suggestions. I flip through the book a couple of chapters ahead of time. You can see I have marked with these removable little like page flag bookmarks, which we absolutely love. I use these in my school books all the time for bookmarks. You can see the pink one here, or my kids use them in their, you know, reading books or whatever. These are from, I think they're from the Dollar Tree, guys, and there's a huge pack. They're multicolored, they're removable, and I use it to highlight in here the books that I have received on hold from the library. So I'll go ahead maybe five or six lessons and look through the books and pick out some, put them on hold at the library. I go to the library about once a week to pick up my holds and anything else. And then I make sure to mark the ones that I have actually in my home that correspond with the chapter. So next week when we get to Alexander the Great, I have the book 10 Kings and the Worlds They Ruled, and I want to make sure to incorporate that. So what it would look like for us is maybe one day we'll read the first section, which is Philip and his son, and we'll do the review questions and narration exercises. So that would be maybe Monday. Tuesday, we would read Alexander's Invasions, and then we would do the review questions and narration exercise. And then depending on how long those take, one of those days, I might also read the section in 10 Kings about Alexander the Great, or this might be Wednesday. And then on Thursday, we would do the map work. So the map is here. It tells you what to do. It says, find this, circle it in red. Sometimes you trace things. Sometimes you draw a line between two cities. Like, these are the two that battled each other. And we do that. And then we usually do not do any of the activities. None. Zero. I'm going to consider finding a way to do some of them next year, but I'm not an activity person. My kids are learning just fine without it. So while I think it would be enriching, it's not necessary. And I feel like I'm still getting so much value out of this curriculum by doing the other things. So that is how we have been doing history. We have been loving history. I've also been taking some of the read aloud suggestions, or excuse me, the literature suggestions, and I read aloud at least five or six of them at the beginning of the school year. And then how we did read aloud changed a little bit. My husband actually started reading aloud to the kids, and because it was his thing that he wanted to do, he has been picking the books, and they have been great books, but just fun books. And so I have been finding more picture books and nonfiction, like I just showed that 10 Kings book, trying to incorporate during the day some of those extra literature and fiction and other types of books to just enrich our study of history. And that's the route I like to go. So we have absolutely loved this. I feel like my kids are learning and they have been enjoying it very much. And I look forward to next year. I'm already excited. Okay, this one's a little different because I got these two books as part of the language arts curriculum for my 11-year-old and my 9-year-old at the beginning of the school year. So they had an all-inclusive language arts program that included more than just one language arts subject. And it also included Bible, which I absolutely loved and one of the reasons I picked the curriculum. So these books are from that. So originally when they were doing that language arts curriculum, at least one day a week, they were reading something out of here and either answering questions or writing a summary. And then when we ditched that curriculum, so if you want to know more, definitely check out the next video I make on the curriculum that didn't work. When I ditched that curriculum, I was like, I don't want to waste these perfectly good Bible books. And so I just had them continue them on their own. So this one was set up where there is a story, and it's just a couple of pages long that they would read. There's usually a little bonus section, some information, primary passages, key verse, wrap up, things like that. This was for my 11-year-old. So he read through this and he actually just finished it last week. So it lasted him almost the entire year and he did them every single day. So I'm just gonna see how many there were. Or excuse me, the first few months he did it once a week. And then from about January on, he did it every single day. So he was able to finish the entire book and he would refer to it. We would be talking about something in history and he'd be like, oh, I just read about Abraham. Or we would be in church and he would be like, oh, I just read about that last month in my Bible book or whatever. So it was really cool. He started mentioning it. I know it stuck with him. And I'm probably going to give him a pass from some Bible stuff officially in our school time for the rest of the school year, and I've got new stuff for him next year. Same thing with my daughter. This was included in her curriculum. She is doing the same thing, but hers have 101, whereas his, I just looked, had 52. So she is only halfway through, but hers are a little bit shorter, like this with one page, and some review questions down here at the bottom. I used to, every few days, open up to one of the stories she had read that week and ask her the questions, but I just didn't have time for that, and it's not how I went into the school year. You know, I didn't plan that into our schedule. This was sort of, it was something incorporated into their curriculum, so it had a plan, but then we stopped doing that part of the curriculum. So it was sort of like, you know what, sometimes good enough is good enough. And it was good enough that she read it, and it was good enough that she looked at these questions. I don't follow up with her at all. She spends the time reading, and we can make adjustments, and I already have plans for different ways to do Bible next year. So she will keep using this, and honestly, I'll probably have her do it throughout the summer. We do a typical school year schedule from about the end of August to about the end of May, sometimes a week or so into June, just because of the weather in our area. It is such a waste to be doing a lot of schoolwork in June, July, and August where I live. That is when the weather is beautiful. We want to be outside taking advantage of the outdoors as much as we can, but I hate having that long of a gap. So we do a little bit of math review. This year we'll probably do a little bit of grammar review and probably something like Bible every single day, plus reading we do all year round, weekends, holidays, and everything. Anyways, I almost don't consider that part of school. So this is something that I will probably have her continue doing, and I will find something else for my son to pick up. So Bible worked amazing, even though it took a little bit of a change, a little bit of a turn. Another thing that's so funny that fit with our language arts curriculum at the beginning of the year were these spelling lists. I actually tore these out of the book. I stapled them together. What we did this year was just very informal. And every single day my kids had to do 5 words. They used these notebooks. I did a whole video on these notebooks. So look for that. And let me see if I can find some spelling words in here. And what they were supposed to do, oh, way back here in January, she didn't do it right. But they were supposed to copy the word one time, looking at their list, and then copy it a second time slowly. And then they were supposed to cover it up and write it one time over here. And then I could correct them. And every, probably once a week, I would pick up the book and I would give them an oral spelling test. And I would have them spell back. My kids, I feel like they're right in the middle of the road. Sometimes I think they struggle with spelling, but other times I'm like, you know what, they're fine for now. And next year I've already found it. I'm pretty sure, a great spelling program that I'm going to do for all of my kids. I'm really excited about it. But when we stopped doing this language arts curriculum that incorporated spelling, I still had them do the same thing we'd been doing since the beginning, which was 5 spelling words a day. So they have made it quite a ways through these lists. Probably won't finish them, but I'm okay with that because, again, sometimes good enough is good enough, and we have not really had some good spelling the last few years. And so I feel like we really made progress, and I have seen an improvement in them through this. So that's exciting. The other thing I do want to show you are these notebooks. Like I said, I did an entire video on these. These were a notebook that I wanted them to have everything all together, and I really don't like spiral bound very much. So that's why I picked this kind. Plus it wasn't too big, had lots of pages, they're inexpensive. So in the end, really my two biggest children, oldest children, ended up using these all year long. The 3 younger ones, I had gotten them books at the beginning of the year, and we were going to do some curriculum that I ended up ditching, and then we didn't need those books for them yet. So for my older 2 kids, they did, I didn't even bring it out. I'm glad I can show you this. We did the Draw Right Now series of handwriting, which they absolutely loved. It had a picture with step-by-step instructions to draw and then some sentences. So they did that for a very long time. They finished that book. Here, I'll show you another page, and then I'll come back to this book. So they finished that handwriting book, and I found them just some random dollar store Learn Cursive handwriting book. I didn't even think to grab it. So they both went through that and now they know cursive really well. And I am going to, in future years, also have handwriting books instead of the draw right now. I liked them, but my kids go through them too quickly. And I just, it's one of those things that it's a little bit easier for me to get them a handwriting book. And then sometimes the content of what they're going to write in the handwriting book, the ones I picked for the upcoming year, I'm a little bit more happy with than the content of the ones that they were doing. So it's just going to make it a little bit easier for me as the teacher. And as far as my kids go, it's going to include the same things they enjoyed, a short amount of writing so it's not overkill and frustrating to them, and also an art drawing or coloring element. So they'll be happy with that. And I get something that's a little easier for me. So handwriting went well. Their cursive books went well. I just forgot to bring those up and include them as this video. So here you can see they have their spelling. And what I really wanted them to do is, instead of making sections for spelling words, sections for handwriting, they were supposed to just flip to the next page for the next assignment that they needed in this book. So if it was handwriting next, they just flip the page. If it was science, I'm pretty sure this was their science, which I'll talk about in a second. Then it was back to spelling. Then here was another handwriting one. We also had our history in here. So must be we did not have a map for a little while because I don't see them in here yet, but I knew we have them. So I'll just kind of flip here until I can find a map. Oh, at one point we were doing these kind of read alouds with my two oldest and they were writing summaries. That was another curriculum that we stopped using. Oh, it's been a year. It has been a year. Okay, so here is history. So we had a coloring page and they cut it out. Here was a map and we pasted it in. So it ends up being this kind of really fun scrapbook of like the whole year. And it was really cool. I love it. My kids, this is something I might actually keep, and I don't keep anything, guys, ever. But these were kind of fun and my kids are still using them, and it's very possible we will just make it to the end of the year with the way we're using it and what we're putting in here. So that was the last thing I think that I wanted to share with you. I'm just kind of glancing back over here to see what other subjects I had. Those are the things that we absolutely loved and we continued to use, things that I purchased and planned at the beginning of the school year that we continued to use, and everything else had some sort of major or minor change that I had to deal with, but I still would consider this year a huge success. I hope this video was helpful as you're considering what curriculum you want to use for your family next year. And let me know in the comments what other homeschooling videos you might want to see in future. I hope you guys will subscribe, especially so you can see and know when part two of this series is coming out. I hope you have a great day, guys. Thank you so much for joining me. Bye.